Good morning and welcome to our session on ecosystem regime shifts, drivers and responses, or as the AGU press corps renamed it, big changes from small forcings. So my name is Daniel Mann. This is Andrea Lloyd. We're the session coordinators today. And I just want to take a few minutes to remind you or introduce you to the concept of what an ecological regime shift is. So the analogy is you're going down a river in a canoe, and the canoe flips over. And there's actually, if you know anything about canoes, there's quite a bit of difference in the stability of the canoes. It has to do with the threshold of the hull stability. So how a system responds, so a system here could be some kind of ecosystem or a geomorphic system, for instance. How it responds is a function of the forcing, so the environmental forcing, and the system's properties. Okay, so back to our canoe analogy, if you have a canoe, for instance, with a flat bottom, it has a very high initial stability, so you can kind of jump around in it and fish for your bass or whatever. But as soon as you tip a flat bottom canoe, there's a very low secondary stability. So in other words, there's a very sharp threshold in stability, and the canoe tends to flip over. So one extreme type of natural system has these three attributes: very abrupt thresholds, so the flat bottom canoe with the steep sides, no intermediate states, so it jumps from one state of being to another, so down the river, right side up, upside down, going down the river, and experience hysteresis, which basically you can't get back to where you started by the same route that you left it. So slow environmental forcing, for instance, you reach a threshold, and then a sudden jump to a new state. So Martin Scheffer has recently published this book on critical transitions in nature and society, which is a really great book for a review of all kinds of neat examples of critical transitions or catastrophic regime shifts. So this is that third type of very abrupt change. So why this topic is important? Well, in our world of changing environment, it's a really good idea to know what kind of canoe you're riding in. How steep are the thresholds, and how threatening are they to us? So our first speaker today is Jonathan Foley, University of Minnesota, and he's going to talk about from regime shifts to planetary boundaries, how nonlinear system behavior is manifest from local to global scales. Jonathan.
Well, great. Good morning. First of all, I'd like to thank the session organizers for this great session this morning. I said I would really love to speak, especially at 8 o'clock in the morning on the last day of the conference, to a basically empty room. I thought that'd be very, very cool. let's bear with us today. So I was asked to talk about some work on that I was done over the last few years. It's kind of a review talk about kind of regime shift and how it connects to across local, regional, and global scales. Basically, the idea of regime shifts is really relevant today because of the notion of what we call, you know, kind of exponential change, the fact that the planet is undergoing incredible changes in the last few decades. If you think about, you know, the state of the world in the last 50 years, we've seen more change in the human condition, certainly in terms of population and economic activity, in the last 50 years as compared to all other human history combined, which is quite extraordinary. And our use of resources, especially land, water, and energy, basically tripled or quadrupled in just 50 years. So this is an extraordinary moment in all of human history in terms of what's happening to us. But it also means that there are rapid changes in the environment. Our use of resources, land, water, energy, and so on are pushing our planet to extreme limits in many, many different cases. So the question that a lot of people are asking is, are these changes in the environment causing so-called, like, you know, tipping points, or, as was mentioned already, regime shifts, which is just kind of a fancy way of saying the same thing, a very rapid change very, very suddenly. In the introduction, this has already kind of gone over, but the idea that in some cases the systems can behave so that they so that their laser pointers don't work. Oh, there we go. So that they may change gradually, or they may exhibit kind of multiple equilibria, or where a small perturbation like this guy over here could result in a very dramatic change in the system. And sometimes systems respond to small perturbations where they give a large change and maybe they have multiple attractors, kind of the system might behave so there's, you know, maybe even multiple equilibria and create this so-called hysteresis effect. So I was going to give a couple of examples of this that if, you know, we think have happened through the planet's history and where this might be going into the future. One of the examples I wanted to talk about this morning was really the history of the Sahara Desert and the Sahel region. Just to kind of orient everybody, this is Africa, of course. This is the modern-day Sahara Desert, which is the largest land feature visible from outer space, a huge feature of our planet. And this region here is called the Sahel, this region basically in Western Africa between the desert and the savannas to the south. The word Sahel actually derives from the Arabic word for shoreline, which basically is the shoreline of the sea of sand that we see in the Sahara today. What's really remarkable about this region, though, is the incredibly steep gradients of rainfall, vegetation cover, and vegetation characteristics between extreme desert and rainforest to the south. It's one of the steepest rates of change found anywhere on the Earth. One of the regime shifts I wanted to talk about happened about 5,500 years ago. What's really fascinating is this region of the Sahara Desert is actually a very modern feature. What we think of as the Sahara Desert didn't even exist on this planet till about 5,500 years ago. There's lots of evidence for this, you know, very different world where the Sahara was not a desert, but it was actually vegetated and full of animals and even human communities and wetlands and lakes. If any of you have seen The English Patient, the movie, for example, you see, you might remember the protagonist in the movie was looking at cave paintings showing a very different environment in the middle of the Sahara Desert near Egypt, in his case. But this shows, for example, about 8,500 years ago in southern Algeria, a man kind of with a bow hunting different kinds of animals, which would be quite remarkable today in that part of the world. If you look at this place here in 9,000 years ago in southern Niger, again, a place you would never expect to find giraffe, but 9,000 years ago, they were quite common. You also see evidence of like crocodiles and hippopotamus and all sorts of crazy things in the middle of the Sahara Desert, really telling us that this is an extremely different environment than it is today. If you were to composite and collect all of these different archaeological and geologic sources of evidence, you can paint a picture of what the Sahara Desert looked like in the early Holocene era. That is about 10,000 to 6,000 years ago. And as you can see, the modern Sahara Desert, which would occupy most of this area here, is actually confined to just this little brown area up here. That's really the only desert region of Africa in the early Holocene era. What is now the Sahara is mostly, you know, kind of Sahelian vegetation, kind of grasslands and shrublands and savannas with very large lakes, wetlands, and animals and human communities. So again, this is a very different place than it is today. What's remarkable about this is that the changes in climate that we would expect during the Holocene era should have happened very gradually, because what drove those changes were really slow variations in Earth's orbit, the so-called Milankovitch cycles, of the little wobbles in Earth's axis of tilt, which is now at 23.5 degrees, was wobbling a little bit. The date at which the Earth was at perihelion, the date at which we're closest to the sun, which now happens in January, was actually closer to July through September during this time. Anyway, these changes in Earth's orbit created a very gradual, over thousands and thousands of years, changes in the solar radiation striking the Earth, which can affect patterns of heating and cooling, general circulation and climate. So, you know, this very slow changes in Earth's orbit, you would think, would produce very slow changes in climate. But in the Sahara, that was not the case. What happened was that this is evidence from dust cores off the coast of Mauritania, showing the amount of desert dust that is produced blowing off what's now the Sahara, that it was basically very, very little dust. This laser pointer is kind of dying on me here. Oh, there we go. Very little dust until about 5,500 years ago, and then a very abrupt change happens, and then it's basically a Sahara Desert right during this yellow period. And so that is a very good example of a regime shift. You know, gradual changes in the forcing of climate resulting in an abrupt change, geologically speaking, in the climate. So there have been a lot of different hypotheses about what could generate this regime shift in the Earth's environment, in this climate. But one of the most promising explanations of, you know, why or how did this happen is basically resulting from biology, strangely enough, that we find that the explanation of our climate is not enough to be just physics and chemistry. We have to invoke kind of a biological hypothesis where solar radiation changes come in and affect the strength of the monsoons of West Africa. But if you have a stronger monsoon, you also have more vegetation in the Sahel and the Sahara Desert. If you have more vegetation, it then amplifies the monsoon rains because the vegetation can basically change the albedo of the surface, and more importantly, the ability of the surface to recycle moisture. That when it does rain, the rain accumulates in the soil and the plants are able to re-evaporate that and use it once more in the monsoon system, kind of amplifying that change. So the hypothesis is that a small change in solar radiation magnified by vegetation, changes in land surface, and the land surface interactions with the atmosphere creates a positive feedback loop that can basically amplify changes just due to solar radiation. And this hypothesis has been tested, of course, not in the real world. We don't have an alternate planet that we can kind of mess with, unfortunately. What we have instead are computer models, like general circulation models, where we can ask, can we reproduce essentially the same effect given a small change over time of Earth's solar radiation characteristics? Can we change the climate in a climate model? The only models that have been able to do this are ones that invoke, again, the feedbacks due to vegetation and biology to amplify the effects of a changing monsoon. This is work by Martin Clausen in Hamburg in Germany, using a climate model that shows an abrupt change in vegetation and climate corresponding almost exactly to what we see in the geologic record. But the only time the models could produce that is when you included vegetation and biology to the climate model, not just the physics. So that's kind of the current state of science in terms of that mid-Holocene vegetation regime shift. But a more recent one happened about 1969 in about the same part of the world, in the Sahel, that border between the desert and the grasslands to the south. In 1969, there was the beginning of an extreme, very abrupt, and very persistent drought. This is the rainfall record of the Sahel region of Africa, showing kind of a wetter period than normal, basically from about 1920 to about 1968. But starting about 1969 to the present day, pretty much, we see a very persistent, multi-decadal drought that has been going on for now about four decades, that has been extreme, long, and persistent. That's very, very unusual, but it's not something that's unique to this period. If you go to the geologic era, you find that these alternating periods of drought and wet periods happened actually for thousands of years. It's very unlikely that this is actually due to human activity, because there are lots of other things happening like this in the geologic record and the historical record. But anyway, one of the questions is, so what could have caused these droughts? Well, many people have tried to explain this in a very kind of linear way of thinking, that, well, maybe changes in ocean circulation or changes in human land use and the grazing of animals, the so-called Charney hypothesis, could have caused the drought. But I would argue, actually, that that's just the wrong question. If we want to explain this drought, we also have to explain the lack of drought before and previous wet periods and previous droughts that happened in the historical record, not just the contemporary one. So there's been a lot of interesting work on this, but one of the things that's, again, kind of a hypothesis that's been put out there is that the question isn't what caused the drought, but what reinforces it and causes it to persist for 40 years. Normally, droughts only last 1 year, 2 years, three at the maximum, but what could cause a drought to last for four decades? Well, again, one hypothesis is that if you have something that disturbs the climate, whether it's changes in sea surface temperatures or changes in vegetation locally due to land use or grazing or whatever, that could begin to affect the Sahel vegetation and climate and cause this, again, positive feedback loop where change in rainfall affects the vegetation in turn changes the ability of the land to recycle water, which in turn affects climate, and then vegetation creates, again, this positive feedback loop. So it isn't really what caused the climate shift. That doesn't really matter. It's asking, like, which butterfly flapped its wings. Almost doesn't really matter. What matters is the state of the system that causes it to be either wet or dry, but never in the middle, which is what one characteristic of the Sahel. Guoying Wang, who's now at the University of Connecticut, did some really fantastic work during her doctoral thesis at MIT, in this paper here, showing again in a climate model, since we can't reproduce this experimentally, that only by adding biology to the climate models could we see the kind of the effects of either a drought caused by overgrazing or changes in the ocean temperature. It didn't matter, but only when you included the biology in these lines down below did you get this kind of persistent drought in precipitation or vegetation cover. Without biology, you see a little drought, but then it kind of bounces back. And the thinner line is the climate model without vegetation. The darker line is the model with vegetation. And so again, what doesn't really matter is what caused the drought. What matters is the system characteristics that reinforce, amplify, and make the drought persistent over time. So that's a very, very interesting mechanism and something that's extremely important today. There have been many, many other regime shifts. I know other speakers will talk about that, things that basically amplify and a small change in the system and then allow it to persist and reinforce it through very large positive feedbacks. There's hypotheses about, polar amplification of climate change or the eutrophication and kind of greening up of freshwater lakes that Steve Carpenter's worked on, or Brian Walker and others who've talked about the kind of desertification of dryland ecosystems. And again and again and again, we find in nature that some systems seem to kind of create this hysteresis effect. And I believe that we have evidence in the real world, but also in kind of our models to try to explain what's happening here. But a few years ago, people started to back up and say, well, wait a minute. If this is happening at local and regional scales, what about the planet as a whole? Are there kind of global environmental systems that create these, kind of tipping points or regime shifts that we need to be very concerned about, especially in an era of extreme global change? And this is kind of, the idea that, do we have a kind of the Earth basically sitting on the edge of phase space where it could kind of tip into an alternate state very, very easily? And, right now we're spinning around on the edge of the cliff, if you will. So a paper that came out by Johan Rockström and a group also including Martin Scheffer, who wrote that wonderful book, came out in Nature about a year and a half ago that basically was called, it was looking at these global regime shifts, these kind of so-called boundaries between one regime and the other, and it ended up being called A Safe Operating Space for Humanity. I was very lucky to be one of the zillion co-authors on this paper. There are a whole bunch of them all over the world. But the idea of the paper was basically this, that at the global scale, are there cases where we see kind of regime shifts where small change in the system can produce a very dramatic change in the environment? This would be a regime shift that is very nonlinear right here. And so you could tip somewhere around that boundary and then fall into a new space. But also there may be systems that are not as nonlinear where maybe just a small change might just gradually cause a big change in the environment, but it's something that's not quite as hysteresis effect or nonlinear. But we basically looked at both of these possible cases and asked at the global scale, for example, in issues of climate change or ocean acidification or what's happening to the aerosol loading the atmosphere or fresh water use, chemical pollution, biodiversity, carbon and nitrogen and phosphorus cycles around the planet and so on, are there kind of planetary boundaries where we don't want to push the planet any further because it would take it into an entirely new kind of system characteristic that we've not seen in the last 10,000 years? Well, in this paper, again, this, as you can imagine, is a very challenging exercise and one very hard to quantify. But we basically were asking, how are we doing with respect to some of these boundaries? In 9 different sectors, this team kind of set out, where's the boundary that if we cross it, we're entering into a new regime in terms of Earth's environment? Well, it turns out we're not doing so well. If you kind of draw these boundaries and say the black line is the environment we've seen in the last 10,000 years, once you cross that, you're in a fundamentally different kind of environment than humanity has really ever seen in our history. So starting in the pre-industrial era, we see very little change. Getting up until the early 20th century, we start to see some maybe effects of climate change, land use, nitrogen, and so on. But basically after World War II, with the Industrial Revolution leading to the Green Revolution, we see we've crossed the boundaries in terms of global nitrogen cycling. We're beginning to cross some boundaries on climate change. We're beginning to see big effects on biodiversity and so on. And this is now the contemporary era. And according to the Rockström et al. Paper, we may have already crossed these planetary boundaries of change on climate change, nitrogen, and biodiversity. So this is a, kind of a startling kind of result. You know, that wasn't the official conclusion of the paper. It was, yikes. But that ought to be the take-home message, is like, wow, we've changed the planet a lot. And the characteristics of our environment are such that, you know, we have to worry about regime shifts now at a global scale, kind of that are taking us far away from the environment our planet has seen, again, during all of human history. So we now live in that era, and it's one we're going to be challenged with quite considerably. So the bottom line of this kind of, looking at regime shifts from regional to global scales is that this planetary boundaries framework, for example, tells us if this is true, and there are people who, you know, argue maybe it's not, but a lot of us argue we think it is, that first of all, we may have crossed already three boundaries that define the human environment condition for the last 10,000 years. We're now on a very different planet than anyone has ever seen before. Well, that may not be very good, and how long we can do that is very much up to debate. Also, other planetary boundaries, it seems that we're pushing beyond those as well, and we're taking the planet into a very different world than we've ever seen before. Again, this was an interesting scientific exercise, but also in terms of our development into the future, it kind of sets boundaries that we say, you know, the police tape you see in crime scenes that says police line do not cross. Well, we're trying to do that with the planet now, saying we really don't want to cross these boundaries into the unknown, into a world that we've never seen before. But it turns out that we're headed that way, almost kind of driving our car at night without headlights on with a blindfold on top of a cliff. So that's probably not a good thing to do. So basically, to wrap this up a little bit, there's lots of other talks coming up that will be exploring this subject in much more detail. There are lots of interesting things about hysteresis and kind of nonlinear effects, but one of the things that's probably most humbling about this, and this is my final slide, is this great book called Believing Cassandra, about kind of global environmental change, written by a fellow named Alan Atkinson. And he wrote, too, kind of a little bit of a lesson to scientists. He basically said, when you review what we've, you know, the predictions of science over the years about what will happen to humanity and the environment, he wrote this. He said, you know, no matter how clear our foresight, no matter how accurate our computer models, a belief about the future should never be mistaken for the truth. The future as such never occurs. It just becomes the present. And no matter how well we prepare ourselves, when the imagined future becomes the very real present, it never fails to surprise. So I guess the only prediction we should be making is that all of our predictions are probably going to be wrong, and we're going to be very, very surprised. So with that, I'll just say thank you, and I guess we have a couple minutes maybe for a question or two. So thank you very much. Well, that's a very good point. You know, some people were very upset with that paper because it, you know, even by defining a boundary kind of assumes that, you know, that we can push right up to the edge of it, and if we go one step further, it's kind of the proverbial straw that breaks the camel's back. Others, you know, didn't really like that kind of idea. But one of the things we're concerned about is that maybe the planet is like that. Maybe it is just one more thing, and then the system kind of breaks and goes into a new state. In terms of, you know, worry, I guess the, you know, well, of course, climate change gets all the headlines, so, you know, whether or not there are very nonlinear responses in climate is something we need to be very concerned about. I'm actually probably more concerned about ocean acidification, things where, you know, say might be very, very irreversible, extremely hard to change, and something that's not gotten as much attention as perhaps it should. But you can pick any one of those and be quite worried. But in the real world, they're all happening simultaneously, which is the thing that's maybe most disturbing, is the interactions among those nine boundaries and which ones we don't have on those nice little graphs that we don't know about yet. Those are probably the things we should be most worried about, is our ignorance. Okay. Great. All right, thank you.
Thank you, Jonathan.
Okay, we'll be moving on to our second speaker, Peter Beck, who's going to talk about the potential for regime shifts in high-latitude terrestrial ecosystems. Peter.
Good morning, and thank you to Andy and Dan for the invitation to think out loud about the potential for regime shifts in terrestrial high-latitude ecosystems. And what I want to do is look whether I think we heard very well that biological systems could exert major influence on how the Earth system as a whole or regional systems react to moderate or large changes. And I want to explore whether we're starting to get a handle on seeing some biological feedbacks that in high latitude terrestrial ecosystems might cause in the future regional regime shifts potentially. And then we'll hear later about some historic evidence for those mechanisms. Got a pointer here. So tundra and boreal forests are occupy our coldest regions on Earth, on land at least, and except in areas where rainfall is too low to support tree growth, you'll see boreal forest and tundra in a nice south to north gradient. And this is commonly known. It's northern high latitudes that are experiencing the brunt of climate warming in recent decades at about double the rate of the rest of the planet, and are projected to continue to do so in the future. And then knowing that tundra and boreal systems are temperature limited, or at least a lot of the ecosystem processes are temperature limited, the combination of those two factors makes it really important to understand how shifts in temperature will affect those entire biomes in the future. Knowing that they're temperature limited and there's a south to north temperature gradient in the northern hemisphere, it's then not surprising that future forecasts of a biome distribution predict a northward biome shift. So these are predictions from Lucht et al. Running dynamic global vegetation models into the future. So the colors show the cover in different functional types in 2100 compared to 2000. So if you look, for example, and these are two runs. One is a moderate emission scenario, a B1, and this is an A2. But they show very similar patterns, just differ generally in their magnitude. So if you focus here on projected cover in evergreen woody forest, you see the boreal zone in Canada losing a lot of its current evergreen cover with projections of temperate deciduous species moving in. If you look at the boreal tundra ecotone right here, you basically see a potential for evergreen forest moving into the tundra with a northern expansion and a northward shift of tree line. If you look at tundra zones, you see similar increases in evergreen forest with potentially spruce migrating north, as well as non-woody cover. So that idea of biome shift over the course of the 21st century, what kind of predictions does that entail, and could we test whether we're seeing any patterns that are consistent with those predictions currently? Very simply put, for boreal tree growth, imagine those evergreen trees in Alaska and Canada. You'd expect them at the coldest margin of their extent, so at the forest tundra ecotone, to be doing quite well with climate warming, and to as the climate moves towards an optimum for boreal tree growth. At their southern extent, in the warmer, drier areas, you would expect them to not do so well, as they eventually are projected to be replaced by more temperate species. So this is from a paper we put out this year using tree rings, and this shows, so this is you can imagine this as tree ring, which it's derived from a moist site in the circles in western Alaska towards the forest tundra ecotone, a colder, more moist area, and then the triangles are from interior Alaska where it's a lot drier and warmer, and you can see that on the x-axis, which shows the temperature gradient. And then the sides or the dots are colored by the year and show the warming throughout the last century. So what we see at the tundra ecotone is exactly in line with those predictions, that trees are responding with increased productivity to the last decades of warming. And further in the interior, trees are increasingly stressed by the warmer climate, which is very much in line with those predictions of biome shift. We then did a comparison of the tree ring data, which is here shown in the circles and the dots, where the circles are white spruce trees, stands, I should say, and the triangles are black spruce trees. And they're colored now by the trend we find in the last 30 years in the tree ring data. The background colors show trends in NDVI, which have been reported to show greening in the Arctic and then more recently browning or decreased productivity, as indicated by decreased NDVI values in the interior boreal forest. And what we show in this paper is that those two very disparate data sets of tree rings and coarse resolution remote sensing line up really well in terms of spatial and temporal patterns of changes in productivity, indicating that that projection of biome shift for the 21st century, that we're seeing now already patterns of productivity that are very much in line with those. As we did this analysis, we of course wondered, well, what's it going to look like at these warmer sites as they're warmed further? Are we going to see stagnant growth, or at what point are we going to see increased mortality? And a paper just came out in Nature Climate Change that looked at mortality rates in permanent plots across dominant tree species for the last 45 years. And each circle here is a set of plots where the red circles are showing increased mortality and the black ones are showing decreased mortality. So at the southern warmest extent of the current boreal forest, they are reporting increased mortality as one would expect as the climate in that region shifts beyond the optimal for boreal tree growth. There's been evidence in the tundra ecosystem from a shift in growth conditions for a while now. This is a work by Matt Sturm and Ken Tape from about 10 years ago, where they document rapidly increasing shrub expansion on the north slope of Alaska. What I think is particularly intriguing about this work in the context of regime shifts is that very soon after they documented, they suggested a feedback mechanism that explains why shrubs would be able to expand that rapidly. And the idea is that shrubs, once they're tall enough, capture enough snow that they modify their local environment. The fluffier snow captured around the bushes itself insulates the soil layer through winter, which then causes a warmer soil in summer as well, or at least in the winter-summer transition, which promotes microbial activity and increases nutrients in the soils and again promotes shrub growth. So you get this vicious circle of a positive feedback that once shrubs are established, they could alter the environment around them strongly enough to promote their own growth. No, wrong one. One back. So this looks familiar by now. We're very interested in knowing how ecosystem states respond to changes in environmental conditions. We're looking for thresholds where changes occur a lot more rapidly. And these shapes depend on the system you're talking about, but also where in the change of conditions you're looking. This one is, for example, more in line with what we're seeing in interior Alaska in terms of spruce growth. The major reason this is so important is because, of course, ecosystems cause all these, especially at high latitudes, strong feedbacks, as John talked about, to the climate system. So we have to understand what the pattern of ecosystem changes to understand how they might affect the climate. This is taken from Bonin et al., just illustrating some feedbacks associated with boreal forest. This is a more recent paper by Swan et al. In PNAS, where they planted trees on practically all barren areas of high latitudes, and their model runs indicate that the increased water vapor from the vegetation has actually a stronger greenhouse effect than a cooling effect through the evapotranspiration, but they only found that when they coupled it with a sea ice model. So there's tremendous complexities there in how those feedbacks might add up. And then, of course, regime shifts are particularly fascinating because, as Dan pointed out, they are rapid transitions from one chain, from one state to another. And once you're in the new state, just reverting the conditions to the old state won't bring your ecosystem back to what it was before. And these, of course, then pose extra challenges to our modeling insights. Back to the shrubs to illustrate that point. You can see shrubless or tundra with only prostrate shrubs where practically all the snow gets blown around, right beside areas where shrubs are growing quite tall. And you'll see this is work by Matt Sturm and Ken Tape again. You can see the snow that normally gets blown around being captured by the shrubs and really altering that local environment. So the way it appears to consist or form a regime shift in the sense that when shrubs grow tall enough and are established, they practically promote their own growth, and even a slightly colder temperature or whatever it was that caused that initial shrub establishment, taking that away is not going to take the shrubs away. So fire is, when you think boreal forest, you have to think about fires also in the context of regime shifts. I think fires are expected to increase in severity, extent, and frequency with climate change over the 21st century. This is the annual area burned in Alaska since 1950. And the current pattern appears in line also with those projections for the 21st century, where we're seeing more regular large fire years, we're seeing larger fires, we're seeing fires burning later in the season. So most of the carbon contained in boreal systems is in the soil layers, and when it burns, most of the carbon emissions come also from the soils. And the gradient of burn severity in boreal forests is therefore associated with how much of the organic carbon is emitted by the fire. So you'll get a deeper burning, basically, in a more severe fire. What then happens after the fire is you get a very strong gradient, depending on the burn severity, of organic layer thickness after the fire. And the organic layer thickness, again, and I'm simplifying a little here, but affects the regrowth after the fire very strongly. When a relatively thick organic layer remains after the fire, you'll get both spruce and aspen coming back, but you generally end up on a trajectory that leads straight back to black spruce dominance. And this, I'm talking interior Alaska now. When the organic layer reaches a certain threshold, or drops below it, I should say, aspen have a huge competitive advantage, and you get a much more aspen-dominated trajectory of regrowth. So depending on burn severity, you get this gradient of regrowth, but it's not exactly linear. So getting back to the nice diagrams everybody's been using, there's a stable state of evergreen black spruce dominated forests in many areas of interior Alaska. Fire brings it out of that state. So you'll, in the current landscape, you see a lot of aspen associated with burn scars, but then succession returns the system back to that stable evergreen state, which will burn again, but that's part of the stable system. Liz Hoy and Eric Siske presented some really nice work on what happens to areas that burn much more at a shorter interval than is common, rather than a fire-free interval of 100 years that allows evergreen forests to reestablish. What happens when they burn after only 30 years? And thinking about the influence of the organic layer depth, of course, two successive fires shifts you along that gradient very rapidly. If you think back of the decreased growth we're seeing in spruce trees from the tree rings, that basically reduces the resilience of the system. Stressed trees can be expected to burn more rapidly as they dry out. trees that are affected by insect attacks, whether they're dead or not yet dead, might also be likely to burn more easily. So the general pattern of drying affects the resilience of this system. So then the question that I ask myself is, when we're seeing more mega, if we see more mega fires in the future that burn extremely deeply into the organic layer, or we're seeing very frequent fires, might we get to a point where we basically go over the hill and we're seeing so much deciduous forest that this pattern of succession that's very common now becomes rare? There's some evidence in the paleo record that about 60,000 years ago, when black spruce first expanded in interior Alaska, a similar feedback happened, but the other way. So you come from a white spruce and deciduous tree dominated system. Black spruce came in with cooling in a wetter climate, but then an intensification of the fire regime followed the black spruce expansion, and you ended up in this system because black spruce is very fire adapted, burns easily, has serotonous cones. So it's the climate regime following a shift in the biological system. Deciduous trees are much less flammable. You'll get a shift in sensible and latent heat fluxes. So the question then becomes, at what point, or might we see a shift towards deciduousness actually feeding back to the fire regime and the climate system then as a whole? This is from a paper that where we looked at current patterns in deciduousness versus evergreen cover in interior Alaska and how it might relate to the fire regime at a very core scale. Green, yellow areas are deciduous dominated. As you get towards the more blue hues, it's more evergreen. And the red areas are burn scars from the fire database. And when you look here at the inset, you see that currently the distribution of deciduous and evergreen vegetation is very much a function of the fire regime. Final example from Siberia, which I think is particularly intriguing, is in northeastern Siberia. In the Holocene, we've had a tundra taiga-dominated system, a lot of shrub and moss in the understory, and there's, of course, these extensive permafrost stocks underneath the vegetation there. In the Pleistocene, it wasn't like that. There was hardly as much forest. It was a woodland, but very grass-dominated. You had large numbers of herbivores, mammoths, and woolly rhinoceros roamed, and there's multiple hypotheses about why the system transitioned, and we'll hear about another one later, but one hypothesis is that it was the herbivore extinction, when human came in, that allowed trees to really get a hold in that system and shifted it towards what it is now. That's concerning in a certain sense because the enormous permafrost stocks raise the question of when and to what extent they might eventually thaw. And forests have a much lower albedo than steppe grassland type vegetation because they shield the snow. And the snowpack is more insulating, so keeping the soils warmer in a forest system. So there's a very intriguing experiment being set up in northeastern Siberia by Nikita and Sergei Zimov, where they're basically trying to force the system back to the Pleistocene stage by reintroducing large numbers of herbivores. Bison, elk, reindeer, and horses. And it's an experiment right now, but it's very intriguing, I think, whether we can use an ecosystem to geoengineer an environment for climate change mitigation. And the idea would be that you would increase the albedo again because you would go back to a system with much fewer trees, and the trampling of the snow would increase the insulating capacity and to some extent, hopefully, prevent permafrost thaw. So I'm running out of time here, but The questions, I think, are very pertinent now are at what spatial extents could these biological regime shifts play out in the future? This is a map of tall shrub cover for the north slope of Alaska. Right now, shrubs are often limited to favorable topographic position here, for example, in the Colville River, which provides gully and some protection. This is the cover of all total shrub cover of all shrubs, not only the tall ones, many of which could grow tall, perhaps if the climate reached a certain threshold. This illustrates the large spatial extent at which fires affect boreal forests. These are all fire scars since 1970, and they're colored by the decade in which they happened. Just to reinforce the point that if we shift successional trajectories, it's going to affect a large area. And finally, this is the latest map of greening and browning patterns, which just brings home the point that we have a biome that appears stressed at very large extents. And I'm going to leave it at that. Thank you.
So we need to move on to our next talk. If you have questions for Peter, we do have some time at the end, and you can ask him then. So our next speaker is Andrew Nguyen, who's going to talk about hyperspectral mapping of the invasive species pepperweed and the development of a habitat suitability model.
Okay. Good morning. My name is Andrew Nguyen, and I'm a grad student at San Jose State University, getting my degree in geography. And I'm giving this presentation in behalf of the NASA Ames Develop Program. This summer, my team and I had completed a research project entitled Hyperspectral Mapping of the Invasive Species Pepperweed and the Development of a Habitat Suitability Model. First, I'd like to give you a brief introduction into the NASA Ames Develop Program. This is a 9 and 10 week paid internship funded by the NASA Applied Science Division, where students use NASA satellite missions to solve real world problems. The students range from high school, one per team, to graduate students. The students are placed in teams of usually five with mentors and science advisors. Although there is support from Ames scientists, the program is student run, student led. And for each of these projects, we also partner with a state or federal agency in order to apply our research for future management decisions. So once again today, I'll be talking about one of these research projects from last summer, 2011, that studied invasive species spread in the South Bay salt ponds. In this slide, I would like to point out our project partners, the USGS and South Bay Salt Pond Restoration Project and others. In an effort to provide habitat for migratory birds and plant and animal species, the South Bay Salt Pond Restoration Project is focusing on restoring the historical wetlands of the South San Francisco Bay. However, restored areas are being aggressively invaded by the nominated plant species Lepidium latifolium, or also known as perennial pepperweed. In the wetland ecosystems of the South San Francisco Bay, pepperweed is a difficult obstacle for completion in salt pond restoration efforts. Also, the invasion of pepperweed can seriously threaten the habitat of endangered species and animals, plants. Understanding changes in vegetation colonization and creating educational and recreational opportunities can help mitigate these concerns. Our first objective was to map the extent of pepperweed infestations using NASA satellites. We used classification techniques on a hyperspectral 30-meter resolution Hyperion image on the EO-1 satellite and a multispectral 15-meter resolution Astra image on the Terra satellite. Our second objective was to create and run habitat suitability models to predict pepperweed spread. For doing this, we created a GIS weighted overlay analysis model tailored to pepperweed spread. In addition, we used the generalized additive model, which calculates the statistical significance that each variable contributes to pepperweed spread. and I'll be talking about that soon enough. First, I'd like to point out our study area. This focuses on the Alviso Salt Pond Complex in the South San Francisco Bay. The Alviso area is one salt pond complex out of three currently under restoration efforts from the South Bay Salt Pond Restoration Project. They are adjacent to and directly northeast of NASA Ames Research Center. And also, I'd like to point out our field sites, which is areas around Ames Research Center close to Alviso, areas along Guadalupe Slough to Pond A6, also known as Duck's Head, Ponds A21, A20, A19, also known as the Island Ponds. As you can see in this photo, there's a lot of pepperwheat that grows around Moffett Field. It's easily distinguishable by its small white flowers. It's also spreading rapidly throughout the United States because of its high reproductive capacity and tolerance to adverse conditions. It spreads through prolific seed production and rhizomes, which allows it to generate from root fragments. Pepperwheat also tolerates relatively high soil moisture and salinity, and so it thrives in restored salt ponds. It also has the ability to modify soil properties, which creates a positive feedback loop in which one established plant can quickly create the ideal conditions for more pepperwheat to take root. We had two main objectives for field work. First, as depicted in the photo on the left, we collected GPS coordinates of pepperweed presence and absence. These points were later used in the generalized additive model and as ground truth points for our distribution maps. Second, in the photo on the right, we are collecting GER measurements with the GER's 1500 spectral radiometer. And the reflectance data that we gathered from these was used in the spectral angle mapper, or SAM classification, for our Hyperion image. 88 presence and absence points were collected from the field, while 800 more presence and absence points were provided by our partners from the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. Additional points were collected from an Iconus pepperweed classification also provided from our partners. These presence and absence points fulfilled part of the GAM requirement of proper analysis and can be used for accuracy assessments for our future classifications. Next, I would like to talk about how we create our maps of pepperweed distribution using classification techniques from satellites. In the spectral angle mapper, or SAM classification, this algorithm, it plots several values in every band for each pixel, and then compares these values to reflectance spectrum by computing an angle between the points. The resulting classification values from ranges from -1 to 1, with values close to 1 being more similar to our reflectance spectrum. The reference spectrum was compared to our Hyperion image to show areas of high spectral similarity to pepperweed. Once the image had been classified, we set a threshold for spectral similarity that would be used to indicate pepperweed presence in the pixel. Based on points from our field work, we set a threshold value at 0.98. Pixels with SAM classification values above 0.98 were assumed to contain pepperweed, while others were not. This results in the map you see here, effectively showing an extrapolation of the reflectance spectrum that we captured out in the field with a GER. We also then ran an accuracy assessment using our own presence and absence points, which resulted in a 59% accuracy. And we believe that the relatively low accuracy of this classification is mainly due to Hyperion's coarse 30-meter resolution image. For our Aster image, we ran a supervised parallel pipe classification. And how we did this is areas known to contain pepperweed by our previous field work were selected in areas of interest. These areas of interest were then compared to other spectral reflectance values in the Aster image, and values that were closer to these ROIs or areas of interest were classified as pepperweed. This resulted in a 72% accuracy. And we also ran for the accuracy assessment, we had 33 presence and absence points that we collected in the field. We also added another 66 randomly presence and absence points that we generated to run this accuracy assessment. In the next few slides, I'm going to talk about how we ran these habitat suitability models. But first, I would like to talk about the variables that contributed to these models. So we had four variables. Our first was extreme pond salinity. These are ponds that have not been breached, have not been subjected to restoration efforts, and have not been reconnected to the bay. These ponds have extreme high salinity and undergo constant intonation so that pepperweed cannot grow in close proximity to these ponds. I want to point out the picture above, which is pond AB1. As you can see, there is barely any vegetation growing, as well as ponds A5. And these are examples of ponds that have not been breached, have not been reconnected, and are not restored. Our second variable was disturbed areas, which is defined as areas that are subjected to human activity or construction, where pepperweed roots and seeds can germinate. Also, natural vegetation is cleared. The photo above shows pepperweed growing in Moffett Field along a road, and it's growing parallel to it. And the photo below shows pepperweed growing around a man-made structure along Guadalupe Slough. Our third variable was distance to water, where water transports seeds and root fragments, with the majority of occurrences happening between 10 and 30 meters of a water channel. Therefore, pepperweed is able to colonize along water banks, channels, sloughs, or tracks. Here's some photos of pepperweed growing along Mud Slough, along pond A20, and areas around Coyote Creek. Lastly, we consider terrain curvature, focusing on the concavities where runoff can collect, thus increasing the availability of water of making pepperweed more suitable to growth. These concavities may also decrease the distance to water table in some situations pepperweed roots can grow as far as 4 meters down, also increasing their availability of water. The seeds that germinate these concavities may have been carried by wind or even wildlife factors, and field observations confirmed that all these variables influence the spread of pepperweed. So once again, here are some photos of pepperweed growing in the depressions or concavities away from water resources and disturbance factors. Two weighted overlay analysis models were built using ArcGIS-10 model builder. The curvature, water extent, pond salinity, and water channel variables were calculated using the curvature and Euclidean distance tool. Curvature was reclassified into two classes. There was the negative and the positive. We threw out the positives and kept the negative values, which are the concavities. We then used the Euclidean distance tool to create buffer zones around the other three variables. We created 5, 30, and 15 meter buffers. These were all then reclassified and given a level of importance from a scale from 0 to 9 in the weighted overlay tool. This map describes the likelihood of pepperweed spread depending on all of these four factors. The white represents areas in which pepperweed cannot grow, and the red represents areas in which pepperweed can grow or is highly likely to grow. Now I would like to talk about the generalized additive model, which is a multivariate regression model. One advantage of the GAM is that we're able to fit smoothing splines into the data and then use parametric data to run the analysis. For the purpose of our study, we fit splines into the distance to ponds and distance to disturbance variables. The GAM also uses presence and absence points to that samples each of these variables. And how it does is each of the points gathers data from the underlying variable, and then takes this information to calculate the statistical significance that each variable contributes to pepperweed spread. Factors displayed here is distance to channels, distance to disturbance, and distance to salt ponds, which were also calculated using the Euclidean distance tool, and then resampled to 1 meter resolution. And curvature was taken from a 3 meter digital elevation model, and then also sampled to a 1 meter resolution to match the other three variables. Here we can see the results of the generalized additive model. We ran an accuracy assessment, which returned an 81% overall accuracy. Areas in red are areas where spread is most likely to occur, and also results of the model revealed that distance to channels, distance to ponds, and curvature were statistically significant at the 0.01 level for finding areas of pepperweed habitat suitability. Also, it revealed that distance to water was the most important variable for habitat for pepperweed spread. I would like to point out the large green blocks on the southern portion of our study area. These are areas where pepperweed is highly unlikely to grow, but they're also urban areas and are not conducive to pepperweed spread. So, in conclusion, areas predicted to have low or no suitability of pepperweed spread are not completely immune and should be constantly monitored. The Hyperion and Astra images were successful at detecting pepperweed in general areas. However, images with a higher spectral resolution and hyperspectral capabilities can be more effective in detecting pepperweed distribution. And also, predictive modeling is useful in predicting pepperweed spread, with the most influential variables being availability to water, soil salinity, and soil disturbance factors. So I would like to extend my thanks and acknowledgments to Brian Fulfrost from Brian Fulfrost and Associates, Cheryl Strong and Nikki Roach from the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, Lee Johnson from NASA Ames Research Center, and Dr. Margaret Andrew from UC Davis. Thank you very much. I would love to take any questions, but if you have further questions down the road, you can contact myself or Michelle Newcomer, our center lead.
I have a question for you.
Okay, yeah, we have lots of time.
I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about whether once you, so if you got to the other side and restored one of these salt ponds, are there features of the native vegetation that would make it, if fully restored, resilient to further invasion? So in other words, can you get back to the other side of the regime shift, get rid of the invasive species, and get an intact community that is somehow stabilizing itself in the same way? Or will those communities remain vulnerable to invasion?
I believe that these communities will remain vulnerable to pepperweed invasion, even though it's been eradicated at the moment. Just because there aren't any natural factors that can mitigate pepperweed spread. So if we were successful in eradicating pepperweed altogether, let's say in this study or in the salt ponds, we'd still have to closely monitor it and try to, if you will, nip it at the bud as soon as it starts out. That's one of the main reasons for the habitat suitability model, is that areas that were least likely should be monitored closely more than areas that are highly likely. Just because it's better to prevent it, or while it's still a baby, if you will.
Any other questions?
Pepperweed is not natural to these coastal salt marshes. I'm wondering if you can tell us where the point of infection came from, where the pepperweed was introduced to the system.
Right. We believe that it came from seeds that was shipped from a shipment of sugar beets back in the 1500s, I believe. And that's pretty much how it started. And then moving along from rivers and sloughs and other parts, that's how I believe that the infection started in the salt ponds that we're talking about.
So where'd the sugar beets come from?
Europe, I believe. I can't really say that for sure out of the top of my head. But.
Okay. Great.
Okay. Well, thank
you. Thank you, Andrew.
Okay.
So our penultimate speaker has already introduced himself, but I'm going to introduce him again anyway. Dan Mann is going to talk about the demise of the circumboreal mammoth steppe as an ecological regime shift.
Switch.
You want to switch?
Are we totally ahead of schedule?
No, we're not. Just by a minute.
Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah.
That's where they are.
Oops. All right, I'm back. Good morning. So this is the title of my talk, The Demise of the Mammoth Steppe as an Ecological Regime Shift, Death by Peat. My co-authors are Pamela Groves, who's at the Institute of Arctic Biology at University of Alaska Fairbanks, Gita Grossa, who's in the Geophysical Institute up there, Ben Gagliotti, who I hope is in the audience right now. He's also at University of Alaska. And then last but not least, Michael Kunz, who's an archaeologist working for the Bureau of Land Management in Fairbanks. So 18,000 years ago, during the height of the last ice age, if you could have tamed the mammoth in southern Spain, you might have ridden it all the way to southwestern Yukon. And then if you could have gotten across the Laurentide ice sheet, there would have been suitable mammoth range in all the way down into, for instance, Ohio. So this was an ice age biome of circumboreal extent, which is now extinct. And the question has always been, well, what happened to it? In northern Alaska, so north of the Brooks Range in Alaska, we had this kind of list of megafauna, denizens of the mammoth steppe. So megafauna is anything over about 100 pounds. The species in red are globally extinct today. So woolly mammoth, short-faced bear, which was kind of a super bear, which was part predator, part scavenger, the Beringian lion, so they're all gone. The species in yellow are locally extinct in Arctic Alaska today. So in other words, the horse, the wild ass, the onagers, bison, saga antelope exist today, but in Eurasia and in the southern US. So they no longer live in northern Alaska. And the species in white, the muskox and the caribou, are still with us. So Arctic Alaska is a very interesting place to look at megafaunal extinctions and major changes in biomes because it's a place where humans have always been a small influence. So at around AD 1800, the archaeological estimate is that the total human population in Arctic Alaska was less than 2,000 people, and most of them were living along the coast. So the large interior area, the little square there, the terrestrial area of northern Alaska, is about the size of Colorado, okay? So an enormous area, very tiny human population, so a good place to try to sort out the cause of megafaunal extinctions and biome shifts. So this map, by the way, is from Martha Reynolds and Skip Walker, and it's showing the different bioclimatic zones of treeless vegetation in the circumboreal north today. So what we've been doing the last 10 years or so up on the North Slope is collecting bones. And so it's kind of fun. You float down these slow-moving sandy rivers. These bones erode out of frozen sediment on the riverbanks. And what you see here is a day's collection. Some of these bones will be incredibly fresh. There's a big mammoth humerus. They'll have marrow and fat dripping out of them and date to 30,000 plus years. But the trick is you can't tell the age of the bone by its state of preservation. So we waste a lot of money on dating bones which are in fact beyond the age range of radiocarbon. So far we have about 290 finite dates, okay, so that's less than about 42,000 years, and we have about 150 infinite dates. So at $600 a piece, that's quite an outlay of money, for which we need to thank the Bureau of Land Management. So this is what our data look like so far. What we're looking at is a probability density curve, and the top graph shows all species of megafauna. So zero is today, 50 is 50,000 years ago. And then I've broken down the three lower graphs are mammoth, horse, and bison. And the dashed line, which falls at about 12,000 years, is the termination of these three now extinct megafauna species in Arctic Alaska. Then you see over on the right hand of the upper graph, the rise to the present, as it's called in taphonomy. So those are moose, caribou, and muskox. Moose is a post-glacial invading species into this region of Arctic Alaska. So a couple of things I want to point out on this is, first, the extreme spikiness of the all species record. So I think what we expected was we'd have a pretty continuous population of these large animals present throughout the marine isotope stages 3 and 2, which is the between about 50 and 10,000 years ago. But instead, it's extremely spiky. And then the abruptness of the disappearance and the coincidence of the disappearance of all three of these big species. If you do, if you wiggle match, okay, so we take the probability age distribution of all the megafauna, and we start looking through the really impressive catalog of proxy climate data that are now available globally, there's a pretty good correlation in places between the bone frequency and things like methane. So that's the CH4. This is coming out of the ice cores, and I picked out two areas where the correspondence is especially interesting. So the first one is between 30 and 40,000 years ago. That's over on the lower right. So the red and the blue curves are from Greenland ice cores. So this is methane in the cores. Up is warm, down is cold globally. And you can see there's a pretty good correspondence between when the bones were more abundant, when the animals were more abundant, we infer, and when it was warmer globally, and hence on the North Slope. And the other piece that's really interesting is between 10 and about 15,000 years ago, where you see there's a spike in the bones as we're warming into the beginning of Dansgaard-Oeschger event number one. So this is the Berlin-Alarid interstadial. And then the Younger Dryas is that little dip that the arrow is over. So it looks like there are more megafauna during times of warmer and therefore wetter climate. So we've known for literally 100 years that climate changed radically at the end of the Ice Age, but what exactly caused the jump between these two states? The grassland pictured in the lower left is a photograph from the Zemovs from Yakutia from their Pleistocene Park. What we're looking at is relatively well-drained, relatively warm soils. Obviously, it's in the summer. Over on the right, so this is what we picture the mammoth steppe being. So we have a lot of grass on this landscape. We have a lot of food available for these big grazing herbivores. Over on the right is what we see today in the Arctic foothills. So just north of the Brooks Range, we have moist, acidic tundra, poorly drained, cold soils. And if you were there on this day, you'd be crawling with mosquitoes. So a very different set of habitats, and something drove the switch between the two. So the idea I want to present to you today is, we can just call it the peat hypothesis. And this is simply that the trigger for this regime shift was the development of a regional peat cover. And so here's a view of on the North Slope today. This is if you take your shovel, which is over on the left, and you just go out and dig a hole. So what we're looking at are Areophorum tussocks. So these are sedges. They're not palatable to most herbivores. And in between are a bunch of mosses and dwarf shrubs. Then we have a thick organic mat, the peat. All right, so it might be 10 to 20 centimeters in thickness. That overlies a thin active layer of, let's say, 30 centimeters. And then you can see the permafrost down below, that kind of sloping area. So this is the typical soil profile that we see out there today. So how could the spread of peatland have triggered a shift in the biomes from grassland, fairly well-drained and productive for large herbivores, to this swampy landscape, which is really most productive for mosquitoes today? Well, it turns out there's a couple of kind of facts of life about peatlands in the north. The first one is that a lot of the non-forested vegetation types up there, in those non-vegetated or non-forested vegetation types, you can only get peat growing above a certain temperature threshold. And it turns out it's about 7 to 9 degrees C. So we need to get warmer than 7 to 9 degrees C in the growing season in order to get widespread peat. If you're further north and colder than that, you will not get peat accumulating. The other really interesting thing about peat is that when you think about it, it's totally obvious. It just doesn't suddenly appear. All right, there's a lag between going above that temperature moisture threshold and how long it will take for the peat to actually crawl across the landscape and become a significant factor. So we've been working on this on trying to figure out, what's the time lag between appropriate climate and widespread pollutification? Pollutification is a fancy word for peat spread. So what we do is we work on chronosequences of meander scrolls. So this one's along the Ikpikpuk River, and we're looking at 0 years on the current point bar. And then we can follow the chronosequence of meander scrolls upslope, and we can radiocarbon date them and figure out how long does it take to accumulate peat. So here's a diagram from one of these chronosequences. At the top, you see the vegetation sequence. Along the chronosequence, we go from grass and forbs to shrubs and forbs. and then we pollutify, so we get widespread peat at about 160 meters out on this sequence. And then the lower part in yellow is shown the active layer, so this is, we take a little metal probe and we go out and we see how far permafrost is below the surface in late summer, and the little green bars show you the thickness of peat. And I put the red X where there's a major change, a jump in the active layer and peat thickness. And we're radiocarbon dating these sequences, and so 500 to 700 years of development is required to get that jump in the permafrost and active layer thickness. So if we look along that same chronosequence, the x-axis is organic layer thickness in centimeters, the y-axis is active layer depth in centimeters. You can see 500 to 700 years out along the chronosequence, we accumulate about 10 centimeters of peat, and after that is accumulated, it doesn't make much more difference. You can put 30 more centimeters of peat on there, and we don't get much of a change in active layer thickness. So there's a threshold. And remember, we talk about that catastrophe fold for a regime shift. We need a threshold, and then we need a positive feedback. Well, it turns out there's a very strong positive feedback involved in pollutification. Peat creates peat. And what it all comes back to this thermal conductivity relationship between the condition of the peat and how much heat it will transmit. So if the peat is dry, for instance, think about a warm July day, it's actually a great insulator. It has a very low thermal conductivity. So this means in the summer, it actually insulates the underlying cold ground and maintains that cool, wet soil. On the other hand, if it's frozen and saturated, as it would be in the late summer or into the autumn and early winter, it's a tremendous conductor of heat. So if there's a 40 times difference between its dry, warm state and its frozen, saturated state. So you can think about it in the autumn and early winter, a peat cover is kind of like a chimney that's releasing or transmitting heat out of the cold ground into the atmosphere. So it's a great way to keep the ground cold. So that's a powerful positive feedback. So now what we're going to do is let's just think about, well, what happened when you combine these peat processes, these properties of the peat, with climate history. And one thing that's striking about the Ice Age, one of the most striking things, is the fundamental difference in the tempo of climate change between the glacial and our present Holocene interglacial. So we had all these strange little spiky things, which are labeled 2, 3, 4, 5, so forth. These are Damsgaard-Oscar events, so these are rapid warmings almost to interglacial temperatures, and they're occurring with a duration of about 1400 to 1500 years. Okay, so it's about 700 years warming, 700 years cooling, back to into the glacial. But notice DO1, so that's the latest Damsgaard-Oscar event. This is the Berlin-Alerud Interstadial, and you see immediately it was fatter and it was warmer. So this is what we think happened during the typical Damsgaard-Oscar event. And the number of mammoths is supposed to represent how big the megafauna was, how big the population was stampeding around up there on the North Slope. So during the stadial, so temperatures below 7 degrees C, so we're below that necessary threshold to get peat development, we have a small but present population of megafauna. It warms up, pollutification starts, greener pastures arrive on the North Slope, and so the mammoth are happy. They're all stampeding around, trumpeting each other. So that's like the more mammoths. But pollutification becomes interrupted because, remember, from our chronosequence studies, we need 500 to 700 years of time to really let this process become effective and trigger its positive feedback. Okay? So the DO events are like, we can't quite get there. We begin to pollutify, but then we get cut off by the return of cold, dry climate as the Earth descends back into the full glacial. So the Berlin-Alerud Interstadial, so this Damsgaard-Oscar event number one, was different because it was warmer and it was unusually long. So it was around 2,000 years versus the 1,400 to 1,500 years for the older DO events. So here's what we think might have happened during DO event number one. And basically what we're doing now is we're pushing the system over this pollutification threshold. So again, we start with kind of a chronic population of mammoths down there. We get a warmer than 7 degrees to 9 degrees. We get peat formation. We get the greener pastures. The mammoths are loving it. There's bison everywhere. Then we actually get much warmer, and we go above 10 degrees. And we know this because we had poplar trees are growing on the North Slope at this time. Pollutification is now getting very widespread because, remember, DO event number one is longer than the 500 to 700 years that we need to get widespread pollutification. So we get peat spread, the ground is cooling off, the soil becomes cold, wet, and we're getting that mossy peat layer. So this is what our proposed regime shift is occurring at that point. This is the threshold of that catastrophe fold. And then we're followed by the Younger Dryas, which is a cold time, but the Younger Dryas is not cold enough and dry enough, nor does it last long enough to reverse the trend as happened earlier in the Pleistocene during those earlier DO events. So we get stuck in this new state of being, which is the present peat-covered landscape. So this model, conceptual model, is consistent with several things. The first, it's consistent with the chronology of basal peat dates from the Arctic. This graph is from Glenn McDonald et al., 2006, and it's showing the inception dates for peat deposits all through, most of this is from Eurasia. So this is as if you went out and you dug a hole in a peat bog, and that little red spot is where the peat meets the mineral substrate, and we dated the peat from that location. So this graph shows that. Miriam Jones has a very similar distribution of peat ages from Alaska. So this is a widespread pattern in the Arctic. So what the hypothesis I just described to you is consistent with the timing of peat establishment in the circumboreal Arctic. This idea is also consistent with this kind of odd pattern with why the North Slope bone probability density distribution would actually peak during the warming stages of DO event number one, which is where we have the best dating control. All right, so the animals peak in number, but then they go way down again. Right, so they're dying off, even though it's warm and wet during the rest of the Berlin Alarid. Okay, so briefly then to conclude, megafauna populations in Arctic Alaska responded sensitively to ice age climate changes. This is not in Alaska, this is probably some zoo in Ohio, but I guess lions don't like snow. Second conclusion is that in Arctic Alaska, so north of the Brooks Range, the largest populations of large animals were there during times of rapid warming. Okay, they were too brief about, so you need, remember, you need the 500 to 700 years to get the peat growth. So we think they were there during these times of rapid change. Pollutification could not occur, and we still had, so greener pastures were preserved. Number three, that these mammoth tundra lions and other megafauna became extinct during and because the DO event number one, the Berlin Alarid Interstadial, was unusually long and unusually warm. So we went above a threshold which had not been passed for more than a few centuries during the earlier warm phases of marine isotope stages two and three. And this pollutification was enough because of the positive feedbacks that I hope I explained to you, to convert a warm, well-drained soil supporting grassland into this present cold, dank soil. And finally, we suspect the demise of the mammoth steppe represents an ecological regime shift triggered by peat seizing control of the below-ground climate. So we're back to the catastrophe fold diagram. So we think there was a peat threshold up there in the top right, and we had a rapid forward shift down at this other state of being, which is where we are today with all the mosquitoes. Great. Okay. I'm supposed to take a question. Somebody asked me a question. Please. How does the peat forming? That's actually a really interesting question, because so you have to have primary productivity has to exceed decomposition activity, right? So it starts on in kind of the lower, wetter areas of the landscape, which coincide or at the same time, those are the places where primary productivity is highest today. So that's kind of why I don't think we need to spread the peat over hill and dale. We just need to get the peat in the, like, in the stream valleys where most of these animals would have been concentrated anyway. Yeah. Yeah, no, good question. So is Dr. Zimov here? Okay. Because he's, as Peter was showing his slides of the Pleistocene Park, so his, which leads, your question relates to that, I think. The problem with the Pleistocene Park, which is a great hypothesis, really interesting thing to do, is we have no idea how many animals there actually were. So were there like one mammoth per square kilometer, or were there many fewer than that? So we really have no handle on what the potential biotic feedbacks were to this kind of thing. So I can't answer your question until somebody figures that out. That's like the key piece of information we need for several reasons.
Andy.
Thank you. And thank all of you for sticking it out until the bitter end. So if you've been here since the beginning this morning, you've heard several examples of regime shifts. You heard about the Sahel and about shrubification in the Arctic and about pepperweed invasion and most recently the demise of the Arctic lions. And all of these examples have one thing in common, which is that they all already happened, or at least already started. So if I can borrow from Jonathan Foley's metaphor of regime shifts as equivalent to driving your car off a cliff, it's easy to know that a regime shift has happened after it happened. It's easy to know that you just drove your car off a cliff, at least very briefly. It's less easy to know that they're coming. And so the question I want to explore to end this is whether we have any hope, if we know enough about an ecosystem, do we have any hope of seeing a regime shift before it happens? That is to say, can we see that cliff before we drive off of it? And I'll ruin the dramatic tension by telling you that I think the answer is a resounding maybe. So this work has a number of co-authors, and we've been using tree rings to try to explore the idea of regime shifts and see whether we think that regime shifts may have happened or may be impending in the boreal forest. So the boreal forest has received a lot of attention with respect to its potential to respond to climate change for reasons that Peter Beck outlined quite nicely, that there are very strong feedbacks of the boreal forest on climate. So knowing its fate in the future is a matter of some interest. But a lot of that attention is focused on the northern limit of the boreal forest, which you see here, where boreal forest grades into colder tundra vegetation types. And there's good evidence at this point that the boreal forest is indeed slowly creeping its way north as it warms. There's been comparatively less attention paid to the sort of warm ecotone of the boreal forest, where boreal forest vegetation gives way to aspen and then to grassland. So this is the southern limit of the boreal forest in Alberta. This is actually not the geographic region I'm talking about, but it illustrates this pattern where you go from boreal forest to aspen parkland to grassland, and that southern limit seems to reflect somewhat different climate constraints than the northern limit of the boreal forest. So at the northern limit of the boreal forest, we think that that ecotone is driven primarily by growing season temperatures. At the southern limit, it looks like it's probably some interaction between warmth and dry conditions. So those dark lines there are isoclines that show the balance between precipitation and potential evapotranspiration. And the southern limit of the boreal forest corresponds quite closely to the point at which that isocline is at zero, where precipitation and potential evapotranspiration are balanced. Aspen parkland then takes over until that value reaches about minus 15. So from the southern boundary of the boreal forest, we could hypothesize that boreal spruce forests are somewhat more sensitive to warmth and more sensitive to drought than aspen parkland. Interestingly enough, there is evidence that in periods of warming, aspen parkland has expanded at the expense of boreal coniferous vegetation. So this is a paper from 2003 showing, I've highlighted in green the area of aspen parkland. This is, again, the southern limit of the boreal forest. And you can see in modern times the aspen parkland making that nice blob in the south. And then on the right-hand map is the area of aspen parkland during the hypsothermal, when it was 1 to maybe a few degrees C warmer in that area, probably a bit drier. And you can see this rather substantial expansion of aspen parkland. Wrong direction. There have been projections of future vegetation at the southern limit of the boreal forest that show a similar expansion of aspen parkland. So on the left, again, is present vegetation zonation with aspen parkland in bright green, and its modeled future distribution in a doubled CO2 climate is on the right. So again, you see an expansion of aspen parkland at the expense of spruce. What's interesting is that the same transition from spruce to aspen parkland to grassland occurs fairly commonly in interior Alaska along steep south-facing river bluffs, where we capture in miniature that very same transition. So this is the place I'm going to be talking about, these places in interior Alaska, so fairly far north, where you have a limit of the boreal forest that seems to probably reflect constraints other than the sort of growing season temperature that is influencing tree line. So these communities are typically very steep. You get a sense of that here. And they support scattered white spruce along with aspen, interspersed with this low herbaceous vegetation that's composed of grasses and sagebrush, that has been proposed as a potential botanical analog for the mammoth steppe that Dan was just talking about. So we've got this gradient from spruce, the dark vegetation at the bottom of the hill, to aspen, to sagebrush, and we would hypothesize that this gradient is driven by differences between spruce and aspen and their tolerance of warm, dry conditions. So in particular, we hypothesize that spruce is relatively sensitive to warmth and drought, just like it is down in Alberta, and aspen's a little bit more tolerant. So we're interested in using this spatial gradient to understand the potential for spruce and aspen to exhibit different responses to warming, and therefore for aspen to potentially expand at the expense of spruce, just like it's been projected to do in more southerly locations. As you've already heard from previous talks, a shift from spruce to aspen really constitutes a pretty dramatic regime shift because the two species have very different feedbacks in the environment, very different relationships with disturbance regime, and if you were to shift from spruce to aspen because of gradual climate change, if you got a sudden shift from spruce to aspen, that could become a stabilizing situation that was very hard to reverse. So what we're hypothesizing is that as it gets warmer and drier, we could see the contraction of spruce from the south, which has been shown in a number of studies. And then we're looking at those little arrows up in the upper left part of that graph. We're suggesting you could potentially see fragmentation in the interior of Alaska as well as spruces displaced off of these warm, dry limits of its range there. So we're looking at a number of different tree ring indicators to help us potentially see whether there is a cliff looming out there over which this ecosystem is about to fall. The first thing we're looking at is the pattern of climate response. So if we compare tree growth to climate over the period of the historical record, we can characterize the climate response of the two species. What conditions do they like? What conditions don't they like? And our hypothesis is that spruce will be more limited by warm, dry conditions than aspen. We're also looking at what the growth response to temperature or precipitation looks like. Is it linear? In other words, as temperature or precip change, do you get gradual linear changes in tree growth, or are there non-linearities that might hint at the potential for very abrupt change in these systems? Our third question really has to do with our ability to extrapolate these results in time. So ideally, we would want to be able to look at these first two things. How do they respond to climate? What does that response look like? And then project forward and say, so based on this, if it continues to warm, then here's what we might see. So our third hypothesis is really starting to get at our ability to do that by looking at how stable the response to climate is over time. And we are based on past research suspecting that, in fact, the response to climate may not be stable over time, that we may see different limiting factors in warm versus cool years. So we've cored spruce and aspen trees all around interior Alaska, 7 spruce sites, 4 aspen sites, along the Yukon River and the Tanana River, and they generally cluster into 3 different clusters. There's a cluster, the sort of easternmost cluster along the Yukon River, then a southeastern cluster along the Tanana River, and then a set of sites right around Fairbanks. And they're all associated with these steep south-facing river bluffs. So I'll tell you first about our supposition that spruce will be more limited by warm, dry conditions than aspen. So here's what the ring widths look like, just to show you the data. So our response variable here is tree growth, which is ring width index. It's a dimensionless index of tree growth. Big numbers mean more growth over time. And what you can see in the aspen from our 4 aspen sites is quite a bit of interannual variability. There are years when aspen grow a lot and years when they don't grow very much. And in general, the years that are bad for aspen at one site are bad for aspen at all sites. There's a nice degree of cross-site similarities. Here are spruce growth clustered by region, and within a region we see a nice pattern of correspondence in growth where, again, there's a lot of variability. There are good years, there are bad years, and in general, years that are bad for one site are bad for all sites. And there's some degree of similarity across sites as well. So, for example, if you look around the 1970s, you can see that in all three regions there's relatively low growth. So what we do is compare growth, spruce growth and aspen growth, to climate. We were using the CREW spatially interpolated climate data, which go back to 1902. And we basically took the year prior to the current growing season. So we start in September of the previous year and go through August of the current year. And we collapsed winter down into two variables, which we call snow and dry winter. Snow winter is the early part of the winter when most of the precipitation falls. Dry winter is the later part of the winter. And then we have May, June, July, and August. And so we're looking at how growth responds to temperature and precipitation during each of those periods. So our first clue that we were wrong in supposing that aspen and spruce might have different responses to climate is shown in this graph here. When you look at sites where we have both species cored at the same site, we actually found that spruce and aspen have remarkably similar patterns in ring width. The years when spruce grow slowly, aspen grow slowly as well. Years when spruce grow fast, aspen grow fast. These data suggest that, in fact, these two species may share some really common limiting factors. If you look at that lower graph, the Nanana site, those aspen are sort of falling off the cliff recently, mostly because they're very old. Aspen are not very long-lived, and those trees are just old and senescent. But other than that, there's pretty high similarity. So we took these data and we fit models using regression tree analysis, and we're able to really describe growth well using climate predictors. So in these graphs, this is just one site to show you how well we did. The green dots here are actual observed tree ring widths over time. The black asterisks are the tree ring widths that are predicted from our climate model. So if you take climate variables, fit a regression model, and then try to predict ring width from those climate variables, you can do a pretty good job matching the interannual variability. You'll see that the predicted values generally have a lower range of variability, which is not atypical for this kind of work, but they do capture the up and down quite nicely, more so for spruce than for aspen, but for both species we did pretty well. So as a first pass at describing what the climate response of these species looks like, we took these what are called partial dependence plots. So for each variable, in this case May temperature, you can look at how ring width, how tree growth changes as that variable changes. So if you just look at the blue line in that graph, what you can see is that growth of spruce at this site is very high when May temperature is low, and then there's this precipitous decline as May temperature warms past about 6 degrees, and then growth is sort of low and steady. That green blob in the background is the histogram of observed May temperatures. So you can eyeball that and see how commonly do the conditions that spruce like the best occur. So we looked at these, and from each of these graphs, we defined the range of temperatures at which growth was optimum. We then looked at that optimum range, when growth is highest, as a function of the observed range of variability in May temperature. So, for example, May temperature ranges from about 3.8 degrees Celsius to about 11 degrees Celsius, and then we can look at where the optimal growth occurs within that observed range. So there's a whole lot going on in this slide, but the overall pattern is really pretty simple. I'm showing you three variables here. This is just spruce. So we have early winter, late winter, and May temperature at the top, precipitation at the bottom. The gray bar, so there's each set of bars is a site. The gray bar, remember, is the observed range of variability in that particular variable. And the green shows you where spruce growth is best. And what you'll notice in the upper graph is that those green bars tend to be pinned over to the left side of the gray bars. In other words, growth is highest at the coolest range for each variable. And if you look in particular at May temperature, optimum growth occurs at most sites in a pretty narrow range of May temperatures, the very, very coolest years. If you look at the lower set of graphs for precipitation, you see that optimum growth occurs in the wettest years, except at a couple of sites where there's a slightly more complicated pattern going on. For the rest of the sites, it's the wettest years where you see the fastest growth. This is not terribly surprising. This is exactly what we expected to find. This, on the other hand, was not what we expected to find. What we found for aspen was exactly the same thing we found for spruce, that in fact aspen grow best, just like spruce, in the coolest and the wettest years. Up at the top, you see aspen growth, and in this case, I've added September temperature and precip because that turned out to matter a lot for aspen. They care a lot about previous fall conditions. And they grow the best when temperature is really quite cool. And in fact, the location of those bands of where growth is optimum are really pretty broadly overlapping between aspen and spruce. If you look at the lower set of graphs with precipitation, you find that at two of the four Aspen sites, they really do like it wet all the time. The other two sites, growth is actually best at in the drier years. Those are sites that are not actually on the south-facing bluffs. These are really productive, sort of flat area Aspen sites that seem to have a quite different response to precipitation. So both aspen and spruce experience optimal growth during the coolest, wettest years. In other words, their growth is best in years that are quite unusual and that are atypically cool and atypically wet, and there's no clear differences between the species in how they respond to climate. So the second thing we wanted to look at was what the form of the relationship looks like. And our hypothesis is that growth is going to exhibit nonlinear responses to temperature. And in the course of uploading this, oh, there we go, it is there. The animation direction switched. So here we have seven spruce sites, and these are, again, these weird partial dependence plots where ring width index is on the y-axis, and in this case, May temperatures on the x-axis. They're all sort of offset from each other just so that the temperatures line up more or less. And what you can see is that at a number of the sites, there are pretty strong thresholds where, for example, if you look at the Eagle site, growth of spruce is high and relatively unresponsive to May temperature until you reach temperatures of about 5 degrees C. Then there's a significant decline in growth until about 6 degrees C, and then growth levels out again. And you see that across sites. What's interesting is that the location of the threshold is wildly different at different sites, which suggests that it's either not a direct physiological threshold or there's some significant variation in physiological response among the sites. So to make a cartoon of that, we see these nonlinearities in growth response to May temperature. You see the same thing for other variables as well, just to show you dry winter temperature. Again, the red boxes are showing where you have some pretty steep declines in growth as late winter temperature exceeds some threshold. So there are thresholds in growth response to temperature suggesting that small amounts of warming in the right time of year could precipitate relatively large changes in growth. So in the waning minutes of the talk, I'm going to get a little speculative here. So this gets to our third question. So just to go back here, both of these first two findings strongly suggest that this is a system that could experience relatively rapid amounts of change with small amounts of warming. You've got species whose optimal growth occurs in the years that are the very coolest and the very wettest in the observed record. So if you warm that system, you're likely to have more and more years that are occurring in that suboptimal range of growth. And then the thresholds in growth response similarly suggest that small amounts of warming could lead to large changes in growth. So I want in the last few minutes to talk about our confidence in the stability of these results over time. And in particular, based on a lot of past work showing that the response of spruce growth in particular to climate is quite variable over time, we hypothesize that different years, different kinds of climate conditions, will actually lead to different growth responses, and that this could seriously inhibit our ability to predict the location of a regime shift in time. So the graph here is the PDO index, the Pacific Decadal Oscillation, which is a climate index that has a significant effect on interior Alaskan climate, so we can use it as a proxy for climate in any particular year in order to come up with a group of warm years and a group of cool years, years that have different climatic conditions, and then we can compare climate response in those two sets of years. And the interesting thing about the PDO index is that you will notice in 1976, there's a regime shift of sorts where you go from an extended period in which PDO is in its cool or negative phase to an extended period when it has been mostly in its warm or positive phase. So what we did was divided up time into all the years in which PDO is in its warm phase, years in which PDO is in its cool phase, and compared the climate response of spruce and aspen during those two sets of years. So these are published data just to give you an indication of what warm versus cool phase PDO looks like climatically. If you look in the upper table at the line that says interior, that shows you the amount of warming on average in the warm PDO phase compared to the cool PDO phase. So we're looking at warm years being 1.5, depending on the season, to 3 degrees warmer in interior Alaska. If you look at the lower table, that's precipitation, which for the most part doesn't differ significantly, except for winter snowfall is significantly greater during the warm PDO years. So Alaska's warmer and wetter, and our question is, does it matter? Do you see the same patterns of climate response during the warm phase, during the cool phase? So what we found first that was interesting is that the first indication that something interesting is going on is that when you split the data up like this, our ability to explain tree growth by climate goes up quite dramatically. So the R squareds here are the proportion of variation in ring width that's explained by climate. And when you look at the all years, it's pretty decent, but when you divide the data up into cool phase and warm phase, for the most part, our ability to explain tree growth grows up dramatically, suggesting that there may be differences in climate response between these two climatic phases that are important. So this is a hideous graph, but I'm going to make a relatively straightforward point with it. So one of the things we get out of this regression tree analysis is a numerical estimate of the importance of a variable. It's a number from zero to something that gives us an index of how important that variable is in explaining tree growth. And so what's graphed here is the median importance value, with 25th and 75th percentiles being the boxes, during warm phase and cool phase of the PDO. And I'm going to show you one interesting thing that happens, which is that the blue boxes are now showing you the four most important variables during the cool phase of the PDO, which are May temperature, August precip, dry winter precip, so that's late winter precip, and September precip. During the warm phase of the PDO, there are four different variables that are most important. And what's most noticeable to me is that May temperature, which is far and away the most important predictor of tree growth during the cool phase of the PDO, becomes completely unimportant during the warm phase of the PDO. Instead, May precipitation starts to matter a whole lot more. So we have different limiting factors during these different climatic regimes. And when we start to look at the data, what we see is that the response of tree growth to particular variables changes in interesting ways. So this is June temperature and ring width, and if you look at the blue line during cool phases of the PDO, warm Junes lead to high growth. During the warm phase of the PDO, warm Junes lead to low growth. And these are just showing the June temperature at which growth is maximized at all the sites during the warm phase and the cool phase. And for six of the seven sites, you see this nice flip that trees grow best in a cool June during the warm phase and a warm June during the cool phase. One final intriguing result. We have some evidence that not only do the limiting factors change depending on the phase of the PDO, so whether Alaska's warm or cool, but the degree of within-population coherence of growth changes. So in these graphs, the blue line is the average inter-series correlation. It's the average correlation among trees in a particular site on a 20-year moving window. So when that number is high, it means most of the trees are doing the same thing. Same good years, same bad years. When that number is low, it means the trees are kind of all over the place. A good year for some is a bad year for others, and vice versa. The red line is PDO during the same 20-year period. And what you will notice is that they are negatively correlated with each other. So when PDO is in its negative phase, when the blue line is low, tree growth tends to be when the red line is low, tree growth, which is the blue line, tends to be very highly correlated within a site. And when the PDO is in its warm phase, that is to say when the red line is high, tree growth tends to sort of fall apart. It doesn't fall apart, but the internal coherence falls apart, suggesting that during warm phases, there becomes a lot of interpopulation variability. We don't really understand this yet, but it strikes us that it's cool. So climate response differs in really complicated ways between warm and cool phases of the PDO. So although items 1 and 2 would lead us to believe that, yes, there is the potential for abrupt change in this system, item number 3 tells us that we want to be a little leery about projecting forward from the last 100 years of results, because it would appear that the response to climate is highly variable over time, and even within a population at certain points in time. So what this means for the future of the boreal forest is really that at this particular location, it does appear that a regime shift from spruce to aspen is possible. But predicting exactly where it's going to occur is a place I don't think we're at yet. So I'm 9 seconds over, so I will stop. Since I'm the last speaker, I will open it up to questions, not only for me, but if you thought of a question for a previous speaker, if any of them are still out there. You can. Oh, I shouldn't clap for myself. Any questions? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, we did. We used we did the whole first set of analyses using the Fairbanks measured data, which actually do a reasonably good job. What we found with those data is that for 4 of our 7 sites, the Fairbanks data and the CREW data are equally good. For those 3 sites on the border with the Yukon Territory, the Fairbanks data really didn't do a particularly good job at describing growth. So for that site, the CREW data made a much bigger difference. Yeah. Any other questions? Okay. Well, thanks very much for your attendance. Oh, wait a minute. Peter has an announcement.
Because Pleistocene Park came up a couple of times, there is a poster on Pleistocene Park in the Global Change session, GC51C. So, just wanted to put that out there.
Right now?
Yeah, it's right now.
Oh, okay.
So maybe You guys can square off there.
We're going to go on a field trip to see the poster.
All right.